Welcome to the Googleplex.
I'm Lawrence Moroney, and I'm here today with Scott Jenson.
Hey.
And Scott is the maestro of all things Internet of Things, and in particular, something called the physical web. So we're going to get together, we're going to talk about the physical web, and I know I'm going to learn a lot, and I hope you do too. So Scott, physical web, that's what we're here to talk about. Tell us all about it.
Okay, well, when people talk about the Internet of Things, mm-hmm. there's so much to it. There's networking protocols and data standards and so forth, but we're trying to solve the front end piece of it, which is to say you want to walk up to be to a device and be able to use it.
Right.
So there's things like the Nest or Bluetooth door locks or zip cars. All of these devices today have an app that you have to install to use, and that's fine if you only have two or three devices in your life. But if we believe in Moore's law at all, there's going to be thousands, if not billions, of these devices, a lot of them in public places. And apps just don't scale. You just can't, if you're in the middle of a mall, you're not going to download an app
okay.
to talk to a movie poster. It's just not going to work. So we're trying to get rid of all of that friction so that you can just, with a couple of taps, interact with the device that you're standing in front of.
Okay, now how does this get rid of that kind of friction? How is it engineered to do that?
Well, the way we're doing it right now is we're using Bluetooth Low Energy. It's
okay.
a new version of Bluetooth. It's extremely low power. It broadcasts a URL in the advertising packet, and it does it once a second, over
okay.
and over and over again. But it's so low power, it's actually measured in microamps, not even milliamps. So a little tiny coin cell can last for over a year.
Okay.
And of course, if you attach it to something that's plugged to the wall, it's infinite. But the intention is that just broadcast the URL over
okay.
and over and over again, and then your phone or your tablet or eventually your headset could then just scan for all the URLs in the area around you and then rank them and let you pick. But it won't be shouty, it won't be in your face. You
okay.
will only be able to do it if you ask for it. You open your phone, pull down the notification manager, see what's nearby, and then when you tap on it, it just takes you there. So it's meant to be you're under control and you do it when you're ready.
Okay, now is there some way of it like being able to filter out the kind of things that I'd be interested in and the kind of things that I'm not?
Well, initially what we're trying to do is to get you to see the thing that you're in front of. But because we go through a proxy server, we can kind of do some safe searching
okay.
and so make sure we get rid of spam and things like that. But we also are thinking about having it have some sense of history so that the things that you use more often would rise to the top, or things in your house
cool.
you could actually star so that it would actually make sure it pops to the top. So we're experimenting with a lot of different ways to make sure that if you do see a lot of things, the things that are important to you show up.
Okay, and you mentioned you're experimenting with a lot of different ways. What kind of stuff have you built? Anything fun or interesting?
Well, what I've done right now is, last year I went and on eBay, I bought a vending machine for $250.
Vending machine.
I brought it myself, took it all apart, and put in a Raspberry Pi, and just to simulate what we could
okay.
start to do. And the idea is you walk up to the vending machine, it's broadcasting the URL.
Okay.
You then go to the website, and then you can use any kind of web payment means that you want to. But then when I actually click on the thing that I want, it just sends a WebSocket message
okay.
from the web server to the Raspberry Pi, which then spins a little relay and it drops the candy. And the whole thing takes less than 100 milliseconds. It's kind of cool.
That is pretty
and
cool.
Now, right now, I'm just simulating just the actual purchase. But
right.
we can do so much more than that, because when I actually talked to Coke about this, they got really excited, and they were like, wait a second, we could like change the whole experience. It'd be like, welcome back, Scott. You want Diet Dr. Pepper, you know,
okay.
and so if you remember, or I see that you've gotten 10, do you want the 11th one free? So it's not just simply about payment, it's actually about changing the entire experience.
So Scott, what is it that brought you to this, and what made you think of like working with the physical web?
Okay. I'm actually a UX designer by training, and I've worked an awful lot with companies that are trying to both use websites and applications, and it became really clear that there was this effort involved with using applications for thin, lightweight things.
Right.
And it became really clear that there's a UX issue involved about being able to get to the interaction as quickly as possible.
Right, at heart, it's really a user experience of technology, right?
Well, precisely, because the web is this really lovely white box we call the DOM.
Okay.
And it's been in all these years, but we on top of it, we have this little URL bar that hasn't really changed in 25 years.
Mm-hmm.
It's a DOS prompt on top of the web. You have to go www.cnn. It's like, we haven't changed that in so long. Why can't the mobile phone browser use the same sensors that every other app has? All the physical web is trying to do is let the browser use the sensors that are on the phone itself.
Cool, so that gives the scenario that you were talking about earlier on, like if I'm in a shopping mall and I see a movie poster, that movie poster could be broadcasting the URL, my phone sees that URL, and then that URL could give me the trailer or give me a link to buy tickets or something along those lines, right?
No, precisely.
Much better user experience than me looking at the poster and then trying to pull out my phone and figure out how I can learn more about it.
Well,
this
and some people have said, well, wait a second, we have QR codes, why don't those work? And QR codes tried to solve the problem, but as we all know, it wasn't very effective because no one's going to take out their phone and focus on one little thing. And we can do 50 URLs from 50 meters away
right.
simultaneously. It's a totally different idea.
Yeah.
And so it's to make by making it UX-driven, we're trying to make it effortless and fast. Right. And the technology, we initially tried using Bluetooth regular and realized it wasn't appropriate. We even tried using Wi-Fi. It wasn't appropriate. So we've been trying to do this until Bluetooth Low Energy came out that actually made it kind of work.
Okay, cool. So you spoke about like the URL almost being like the DOS prompt of the internet. So, and this thing's broadcasting URL. So does that mean it's like just a browser-only technology?
Well, the advantage of URLs is they're so flexible. So initially, having a URL take you to a web page is the quickest, lightest way to go. But it can also deep link into a native application.
Okay.
So when I was talking to one company that wanted to use this, they already have an app. But they love the idea that the web browser would allow someone to walk up to their device and use it, you know, right away. And then once they kind of get hooked, they can install the app and then get a different kind of experience. So URLs cross both boundaries, which is really quite nice.
Cool, yeah, because of course it can describe a web location and it can describe context in an application.
Well, and also URLs are just really flexible in cool ways. Like I have a temperature sensor and the URL can actually add ampersand T equals 72.
Yep.
So the URL can dynamically change. Or if you want to have a URL with an 8 or 12 digit rotating ID that can't be copied or spoofed for extra secure applications. So the URL provides a lot of levers that we can pull and grow over time as this changes.
Cool, so that makes it really flexible.
Yes, exactly.
Awesome, cool. So now this kind of thing has got to be open for everybody to be able to build with, right? Mm-hmm. Or it doesn't really work. What's the developer story behind this?
Well, because I'm on the Chrome team and we're filled with a bunch of goody two-shoes in the Chrome team, we just really want everything to be open. And it's kind of a really cool team to be involved with that. This is completely open source. So our prototype app is open source, the proxy server, the Beacon firmware, all of it is wide open in there to be used. Okay. And we would very much want this to be effectively an extension to the browser. So we want this to be on every platform, every browser, everywhere. And so this is not a Google product.
Okay.
And I mean, we're going to be implementing it, you know, through Chrome eventually. But the goal, though, is to have this be available to everyone.
Okay. So is there any way that, where would the source be, or where can developers get started with looking at this?
So we have a GitHub.
Now? There is a GitHub, okay,
yeah, and we have two GitHubs. We have one for the overall project called the Physical Web, which has the application and the proxy server. And then we have a separate one for just the beacon, which is called URI Beacon, URI Beacon.
Okay.
And the intention is that we're trying
to... That kind of URI.
Yes. And we're trying to create two different, effectively, ecosystems. We're trying to create an ecosystem of devices that are broadcasting.
Okay.
And they're just always broadcasting the URLs. And that needs to be massively open. And that's where we're using the Bluetooth low energy standard and the advertising packet. And it's just broadcasting those things over and over and over again. And then we have a whole other cloud of devices that are listening and ranking. And we hope to be a lot of experimentation.
Okay.
There's already somebody who's implemented it for Google Glass, for example.
Nice.
And someone is trying to for Firefox OS and things like that. So we've got lots of different groups that are playing around with it. And they may try different ways of ranking and organizing them. And that's to be expected. And
sure. We
hope that happens.
Now, you mentioned on the hardware side there's Bluetooth Low Energy, right? Mm-hmm. Is that the only standard or are there others?
Well, that Bluetooth Low Energy is kind of the new black. Everyone's excited by it. Everyone's doing that. But we also have support for MDNS, which is a Wi-Fi-based technology, which is really handy so that if you're in your house, you don't necessarily want your neighbor to know that you just bought a 120-inch television, right?
Right.
We actually have ways around that. We talked about ways, for example, that your TV could be broadcasting an obfuscated URL, and then when you walk up to it and you first buy it, you could push a button, and then it gives you a URL that you could connect to, and then it gives you a cookie because it's the web, and then only you can connect to it. So that's one way around it, but MDNS goes through your Wi-Fi network, which really is much more secure. And we've even had a German research company, Fraunhofer, just go to our GitHub and they added UPnP support as well.
Cool.
So we're trying to effectively be the technology of broadcasting URLs.
Okay.
And we want to have multiple ways in which it can happen. What I have noticed is that people love open source projects as long as you do all the work. So I think what people are waiting for is for Google to kind of get behind this and to really push it.
Okay.
And then once we get behind it and start going, then they're going to say, it's open, right? You know, and I think that's the important part about this, is that we have to kind of make the market and we have to kind of get people excited. But frankly, that's so not a problem. We already have people like chomping at the bit that we just have to kind of get the ecosystem going. And so we're really hoping that Microsoft, Firefox OS, even Apple will kind of say, hey, you know, we can kind of get on board with this too.
Right. Now, is this something that has to be built into the browser, and that's why you mentioned those companies?
Well, building it into the browser, we feel, is the best way to do it, because that way it offers, again, more competition.
Yep.
So if Chrome did it and Firefox did it, and you had them both, we can pick and choose which way you want to do it. So we think this is more appropriate at the browser level than it is at the operating system level.
Makes perfect sense. Cool. So everybody, that's it. We're finished in our chat with Scott for today on the physical web. Thanks, Scott, for being here.
You're welcome. Glad to be here.
I've learned so much in just these few minutes, and I hope you have too. And be sure to go check out the GitHub. On GitHub itself, you can just search for physical web and you'll find everything that Scott has spoken about. And I believe, Scott, you're constantly on there, you know, fixing code, answering questions and all that.
That's
kind of
thing. That's how we want to engage with people. That's the best way to do it.
All right. So thanks, everybody. And again, thanks for Scott.